Good morning. Welcome to church. We're excited to have you here with us. We're looking forward to our worship time together with you. If you're able, please stand. Let's sing together.
Good morning, church. It was a stormy night last night, but we're all here and we're thankful for that. Thank you for coming, those of you in the sanctuary, online, and in room 103. Children churches again today, and we'd invite anyone third through second grade after the announcement time to come on up and join us for some fun time. If this is your first week, please have a parent come up and sign you in and register you. Communion is later. We want to just reflect on what Jesus has done for us today, so please be prepared for that later in the service. The Elizabeth House is something that our women's ministry has been partnering with, and we are closing that today, but I just want to take a moment to thank you. The Elizabeth House is a home set up for women who've usually in unplanned pregnancy situations that are high risk, where they need to have a safe place to live. And we, for weeks, have been supporting them with belongings, wish lists, things they need. And just want to thank you for your prayers and your services over that. And if there's any time you have a question or want to give again, please reach out to Joan or myself. Celebrate Recovery is now started on Thursdays at 6:30 here in the church, inviting anyone to come. No pre-registration. Please come, show up, see what it's about. Celebrate Recovery is a Christ-centered 12-step recovery program from anyone struggling with pain, hurt, or addiction of any kind. It's a safe place to find community and freedom from the issues that are controlling our life. Amen, right? All right. Foundations of Faith. Today we're on question number 27. Are all people, just as they were lost through Adam, saved through Christ? No. Only those who are elected by God and united in Christ, to Christ by faith. But nevertheless, God in his mercy demonstrates common grace, even to those who are not elect, by restraining the effects of sin and enabling works of culture for human well-being. From the verse Romans 5:17, for it, because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Tim Keller has this to say, and so again, here's that very helpful balance that we should all strike for. On one hand, no, not everyone is to be saved. No, not everyone has the saving grace of Jesus Christ in their lives. But on the other hand, we must appreciate the common grace that God gives across the whole human race. All right, at this time, Mason, do you want to come up and tell us about your adventure this summer?
Thanks, Billy Joe. Yeah, so those who don't know me, my name is Mason Gassman, and I actually grew up going to Graceway Church. I've been going here since I was in like fourth grade or something when the Baumans invited me to Awana. So this has been my home church for a long time. And so I'm going back for my last year of college this fall at the University of Wisconsin Stevens Point to study biology. And this summer, the Lord called me to Anchorage, Alaska for 2 weeks. Now, a lot of the congregation members here, as well as the church herself, helped financially support me and answer the Lord's call. So I wanted to come here and give you a little bit of a summary of what I did and how I saw God move in the city of Anchorage. While we were there, got to take a breath. I haven't been in front of people in a while. So the three main things that stuck out to me were we had daily training sessions in which we were taught how to more effectively share our faith. We then were set loose into the city of Anchorage to bring the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ to the people of Anchorage. And then finally, we did a Bible study on the book of 2 Timothy. So the first big thing, like I said, were the training sessions. Every day, we would meet at a church in Anchorage to be trained on how to better share our faith in random evangelism. We were taught the value of listening to the stories of the people we were talking to, remembering and using their name. And one thing our leaders would quote to us ad nauseum was taking a step of faith and leaving the results to the Holy Spirit. Another big idea that was taught was the four steps or roles of personal evangelism, those being the explorer, the guide, the builder, and the mentor. The explorer is one who initiates conversations with others, breaks the ice, and gets the ball rolling. Believe it or not, this is a little tough for me to do. I like to meet new people. But it's kind of hard walking up to someone that you don't know and being like, hey, we're going to have a conversation that's going to make you question your entire worldview. You ready? So the next one is the guide. The guide is one who tries to steer the conversation towards spiritual topics and eventually, hopefully, Lord willing, bring up a gospel presentation. Thirdly, the builder helps bridge the gap to following Christ. If someone is discerning Christianity and is legitimately interested to learn more, this is where the builder comes in. And last is the mentor. The mentor is one who encourages and disciples new and young believers. Ideally, we want to be all four of these roles to people in our life, depending on where they are. You know, you're a coworker. You know, I work with a lot of people who aren't saved, so I try to be the explorer or the guide to people that I work with. Or with my friends that might be a little newer in their faith, I tried to be the mentor. Or if someone's legitimately asking questions about Christianity, like, why did God create mankind if he knew that they were going to fall? That's when it's time to be a guide. So the next big part that we saw the Lord move in Anchorage was our random evangelism. And I saw God grow me the most in this aspect of my faith through this trip. Now, providentially, I was reading a book titled Evangelism and the Sovereignty of God by J.I. Packer on the plane flight and when I had free time. This book stressed the relationship of God's complete and total sovereignty over all creation, including the salvation of mankind, and still the responsibility that we have to evangelize. I was shown the necessity for evangelism while we were in Anchorage, because that city is absolutely plagued with spiritual darkness. From the homeless problem, the rampant homeless problem, so many people are overdosing in that city, to mall security guards asking us to leave the mall and following us out, that actually happened. We had someone ask us to leave the mall, and they followed us from a distance, peering at us from like a story up. So what that city needs, really, is the good news of the gospel. As Paul says in Romans 10, verses 14 and 15, how then will they call on him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach good news. Now, I've gone out sharing a few times with my discipler back at school, but I've always dreaded it, I must admit. But the Lord showed me through this trip the need of the gospel proclaimers everywhere, especially at a secular school like the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point, where postmodernism and moral relativism reign supreme. And thirdly, we went over the book of 2 Timothy. We were separated into groups where two leaders would help conduct a Bible study on the book of 2 Timothy. Now, while I was there for 2 weeks, I probably read the whole book like 4 or 5 times. And the greatest takeaway from me was to contend for the faith, to defend the truth, and to defend the gospel. In today's culture where anything goes and morals are as gray as the storm clouds, last night, really, the Bible makes many truth claims and tells us what is right and wrong. And we've been given the keys to eternal life from God, those being the gospel. Paul exhorts Timothy to forge on as farmers and soldiers do, to patiently expect the harvest and to fight for something that we love. We've been given truth and answers for life. 2 Timothy 3:16 reads, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. Knowing this, we must stay true to the faith that has been once and for all delivered to the saints and not keep it hidden to ourselves, but to take it and proclaim it to all who listen. So with all these things that I've learned, from learning how to share my faith to actually getting out and growing and practicing what I learned, to also seeing the scripture behind it, I hope to be a light for Christ, both in Stevens Point, Wisconsin, here in Sauk City, and really wherever the Lord takes me. Thanks.
Thank you, Mason. I had Mason in my Awana group when he first started, and one of several things I remember is that he knew a lot of big words and what they meant. Besides being an accelerated speaker, Mason also is good at hiding his emotions. Recently, my wife and I were privileged to be at the Gassman's house for a Sunday afternoon, and Mason's girlfriend Jamie was there, and the topic of getting engaged came up, and I was razzing Mason about the Nike theory I have. Just do it, you know. And so whatever. So they took off and went somewhere for a little while and came back, and she was engaged. He had the ring in his pocket the whole time. Never blinked an eye. Which leads me to our next point, and that is engagement in marriage leads to consequences. Leanne Hansen had baby Jovi Lynn Friday afternoon, I think a little after noon. And baby Jovi joins dad Tim, sister Bryn with two N's, and brother Eli. Which leads me to the next thing. In today's sermon, we will be hearing Brian tell us about ways that we as a church can minister to others in the aftermath of the overturning of Roe v. Wade. We also can and should be ministering to others in our own day-to-day lives, as Mason was giving us some great ideas and examples there. All of us have opportunities to speak and interact with these or those people we may encounter every day. We have just listened to Mason fill us in with some of his life and what he is doing with it. For all of us, I feel that our day-to-day life or the ordinary stuff may be our biggest mission field. As an example of this, I'm going to read a few excerpts from a book which I think shows the gospel with feet and the fact the Sabbath was made for man and the importance of an example to those around us. From a book titled A Pioneer's Search for an Ideal Home, it's a book about 25-year-old Holden Judson and his 20-year-old wife Phoebe who left their house, or their home I should say, in Ohio on March 1st, 1853. On May 1st, 1853, they left St. Louis for the approximately six-month journey on the Overland Trail heading for the newly created Washington Territory in a wagon train consisting of six prairie schooners. So this is from the book. The first Sabbath of our journey over the plains found us encamped on a beautiful rolling prairie covered with a luxuriant carpet of grass as green as a meadow. The wide-spreading plains, as far as the eye could reach, presented a picturesque scene whose silent beauty awakened solemn thoughts that impressed one with awe and reverence. Here, we were isolated from the world, and in this secluded, romantic spot, we were free to worship our Maker according to the dictates of our conscience. So every Sunday, they would stop, rest. They would have a Sunday morning service, and the men would take turns doing the service, and they talked about the gospel the rest of the day. Back to the book. Only one incident occurred to mar the harmony of that day of rest, the first Sabbath that they celebrated. Our Missouri family, though God-fearing Christians at home, seemed to think that they could not afford to keep the Sabbath day holy while traveling on the plains. When they found they could not prevail upon our good captain to break the Sabbath, they gathered up their stock and, after saying goodbye, pulled out. Fast forward 7 weeks. It's another Sabbath day. The Sabbath dawned most serenely upon us, a bright, lovely morning, the 26th of June. I am certain of that date, for the day was made memorable to me by the birth of a son. So he had a son in the wagon train. Sunday evening, who should come rolling into camp but the Missouri family, who had left us on our first Sabbath encampment because they feared to take the day for rest. We suppose they were 1 week in advance, but here they were 1 day behind. Truly, we have been favored by traveling with a company who believed in resting 1 day out of seven. They practiced the gospel. Let's bow our hearts to our Maker. Lord of all creation, we are living in challenging times where it seems that we have little to no say in what is happening in our world. We may feel frustrated and challenged how to function in society. Sometimes the world appears to be so complicated with too many choices. We are inundated with things to do, many of them not so good. But as Phoebe's story emphasizes, it is our day-to-day obedience that you desire from us, Father. Help us, Lord, to be obedient to you, to live lives that follow your precepts, allowing our light to shine unto those around us. We know your yoke is easy and your burden is light. Amen. Come soon, Lord.
Please stand again if you're able, and we'll continue with singing. Light of the world.
with wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
children can be dismissed now for children's church.
Team. Good morning. We are going to take a break this morning from our study in the book of Numbers with a condensed teaching time. I have chosen to go a different route. It seemed to me and to the elders an appropriate opportunity for us to address the current debate in our nation over abortion. To clarify what Scripture has to say about this topic, and to ask, how is it that we're to minister after Roe? On June 24th, the Supreme Court issued its ruling in Dobbs versus Jackson, overturning the previous decisions of Roe and Casey, and insisting that the Constitution does not confer a right to abortion. As a result, states will be allowed to decide their own policies concerning abortion. For those who've prayed and labored long in the pro-life movement, this is a monumental event. They see it as an answer to prayer. They see it as the restoral of a sanctity to human life. It gives them hope that many babies will be saved in the future that would not have been otherwise. But this is an extremely controversial decision in our nation. And given the size of this gathering, it would be foolish of me to assume that we are all of the same opinion on this. There are likely those here or who are listening online who are angry about this decision. You see this as an attack on women, as the reversal of hard-fought advancements, as the unfair removal of a long-standing right. And there may be others who find themselves suddenly facing an unplanned pregnancy, that with the uncertainty of how Wisconsin's law is going to be handled in this matter, you find yourself suddenly highly concerned. What are your options? And I'm likely addressing men as well as women who have participated in abortion in the past, either by encouraging it, financing it, driving someone to a clinic, or undergoing the procedure. May I just say, if you find yourself in one of those categories, you're in the right place today. I've not hidden from you my pro-life convictions over the years, and Graceway has taken a stance that has been pro-life, to my knowledge, since its inception. But we've accompanied that with the insistence that we take care of people. We don't have to agree on everything in order to respect and care for one another. And in a culture that prefers echo chambers, where everyone that is surrounding us says the same thing, agrees with us on everything, where civil and gracious conversation and discourse about hard topics are really rare, and we need a place where we can safely converse with others and sort out what we're thinking on these things. The church ought to be one such place. I know it has not always been that way. When we fail, we need to acknowledge that and strive to do better. But the church ought to be one of those safe places where we can converse with one another. So I'm glad you're here. You may find yourself frustrated with what I say. That's okay. You may be frustrated with what I don't say. And that's okay. My invitation, though, is would you please come? Let's talk. Let's converse about it. My intent today is not to start a fight or dredge up old sorrows, but rather to help us think biblically about the situation as it stands before us, and to urge us to minister in a fashion that honors our Lord and the people he's put in our circles. I don't do this often, but I feel compelled to address this because of the saturation we experience in our culture. Younger generations in particular are awash in media that promote abortion as normal and desirable and insulate this generation from even considering an alternative view. For example, a 2021 TikTok video clip of students walking out and a pro-life speaker at a Catholic high school secured 2 million hits within a week. As news media applauded the students as courageous, they also abandoned their commitment to dialogue. Rather than subject their viewpoint to a free exchange of ideas where arguments are evaluated rather than simply canceled, the students simply refused to consider a viewpoint different than their own, and for this, the press congratulated them. We have a problem in our society. All across the political spectrum, where the tactics of name-calling and ridicule and the use of slogans are designed to silence conversation and not advance conversations. So let me take just a few minutes and explain from scriptures how we arrived at our pro-life stance. And then I want to talk to you about how we can and need to minister in a world after Roe. If you are like me, you were going about your life focused on yourself, focused on your needs, your pursuits, when God arrested you. He persuaded us that our lives were lived in violation of his standards and that we justly deserved the separation from him as a consequence. And then he directed our attention to the person and work of Jesus Christ, who in his life, death, and resurrection made provision for our forgiveness and salvation. And in the scriptures, we have found a historically reliable account of this man, Jesus. An amazing man of incomparable worth. At his invitation, we've begun to follow him, to live our lives seeking to obey him, recognizing his unique insights, and that he spoke the truth on all that he said. We listen to what he has to say on the various things, and one of those has to do with the scriptures. And he affirmed that what we have in the scriptures is a message from God for us, that they're true and that they're reliable. And so when we look into the book, we find an assertion that God made mankind in the image of God. That as humans, we are made to reflect God in some fashion, that we are like him. That even after the fall in the Garden of Eden, mankind retained that likeness and that imaging role, passing it on to successive generations. Though sin had defaced God's image, it did not erase it. Because mankind is made in the image of God, all humans retain value and dignity. Human life, bearing God's image, is therefore to be protected. Again, in Genesis, the prohibition against murder is based on this truth. Man is made in the image of God. In fact, the Apostle James taught us not to even curse another person because of the same reason. Made in the likeness of God. And so we are to treat other humans with respect, with dignity, with honor, because mankind's unique in all of creation because we are stamped with the image of God. I know some would argue that while the preborn might be human, that they might be alive, they don't yet qualify as persons worthy of the same protections. That contradicts what we find in Scripture as well. Both Jeremiah and Isaiah, prophets of the Old Testament, spoke of their calling from God as occurring while they were in the womb. King David affirms the Lord's creative workmanship of the preborn. In the New Testament, the Greek term brephos is used 8 times. On 6 occasions, it speaks of a young child, an infant, a newborn often, as it does of the baby Jesus, newly laid in the manger at his birth. But on 2 other occasions, it refers to a child still in utero. Same term. Baby, baby. Different size, different age, different location, but viewed as the same. These are some of the basic building blocks from Scripture that undergird my pro-life understanding. But you don't have to buy into the authority of Scripture in order to come to the same conclusion. There are solid, compelling, scientific and philosophical reasons to support this as well. And we would do well to learn those and be able to converse about them if we're going to dialogue with secular-minded people who don't subscribe to our religious convictions. So let me say this about ministering to others. We need to take care of people. In a world after Roe, we need to take care of those who've participated in the past in abortion. In the past year, I've had conversations with multiple individuals who've had an abortion, and far from the unfettered liberty that is promised, they've talked about scars. Emotional, spiritual, and yes, even physical, that are hard to heal. I just want to say, if you are drowning in shame, you desperately need to hear that Jesus loves you and died for your sins. Yes, even your abortion. In John 8, Jesus said to the woman caught in the adulterous affair, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Jesus neither stoned her for her sin nor condemned her for her sin, but he died for her sin. There is healing, there is forgiveness, and Jesus can make all things new. We also need to take care of those men and women who find themselves facing an unplanned pregnancy. They're going to need someone to walk through this with them, not just during a pregnancy, but after it, or raising a child. Ministry can look like being part of their support network, helping them connect with other resources, and one of those, which was featured earlier in our announcements, is CareNet Pregnancy Center. You've heard about it from Billy Joe, the Elizabeth House, the other aspects of that ministry. She and her co-workers are good people who are caring well for those who are facing an unplanned pregnancy. Part of our ministry can just be awakening and making people aware that it exists. They've been doing this for decades. They're good at what they do. We want to continue to stand alongside of them. And so I anticipate that their demand for their services is going to be ratcheted up. They're going to need more funds, more paid staff, more volunteers, more prayer support, more donations of supplies. And so maybe that's a way, as individuals, we can ratchet up a notch on our support. That doesn't even begin to talk about the need for foster care, for adoptive parents. This is a huge subject in limited time. Let me press on to one other category of people. We need to take care of the people in our circles of influence. In our circles of influence. I want to conclude by emphasizing the need for persuasive conversations. With the shifting of governing authority on this matter back to elected representatives at both the federal and the state levels, the strategic importance of engaging in persuasive conversation with fellow citizens who elect those officials suddenly increased exponentially. If we're going to minister effectively in a after-row phase of life, we've got to get good at conversing with people on this, and we have enormous obstacles to doing so. We need to plan. We need to prepare for those conversations. I pray for believers in Jesus Christ to represent him well, honorably, with our families, as we engage our neighbors, as we talk to elective representatives on this matter. And we need to think in advance, not just about the content, but the manner and the tone with which we engage in these conversations. May it be compassionate, yet convictional kindness. Compassionate, yet convictional kindness. I want to suggest to you maybe the place to begin with our neighbors and our friends and our co-workers is not with talking, but with listening. Asking questions. What do you think? What do you think about this issue? And then listen. Ask follow-up questions. What do you mean by that? Clarify. Why do you think that way? What leads you to that conclusion? What's maybe the most persuasive element that supports that for you in your mind? Maybe some of those conversations, that's all the farther we get. Listen, in this culture, that would be breaking new ground. Stephanie Gray Connors, who does this for a living, teaches others to do the same, has written this in her book, Love Unleashes Life. For over a decade, it has been my full-time job to have abortion conversations with people who don't share the pro-life view. While it can be tempting to focus more on what we are saying than on who we are saying something to, countless interactions have taught me the importance of looking at a conversation as an encounter with another soul. How important it is that we be gentle with people, that we not make assumptions, but instead that we seek to understand. She advocates the use of questions. She says this, questions create an atmosphere of respect where people listen to one another And that leads to understanding. And in order to understand, we need to listen deeply to what the other person says. If people see that we have a strong mind and soft heart, they'll be more likely to dialogue with us and consider what we have to say. It's imperative that pro-life convictions not override pro-life compassion. Because it's not so much about simply winning a debate as it is about changing hearts. That our conversations would be marked with compassion yet convictional kindness. I have in my mind as I talk about that a face-to-face conversation. Can this happen over the internet and social media? Maybe. I'm really uncomfortable with that. Perhaps that's how it has to happen. Maybe it is a phone call. Maybe it is something else. But, boy, eyeball to eyeball, face to face, hard to beat that. If we're going to minister effectively, we need to listen well and be prepared with an answer should they return the favor and say, "What do you think?" To that end, I've assembled some resources in the sermon notes, which I have misplaced in the process. That's right. Nope, there it is. Thank you. Some of them are on the round tables as you exit today. You can find them there. But a number of resources that are there. If you're watching online, you can look at it anywhere online where the sermon is shown in our website. But a number of resources there, including a couple books on this topic about how to talk persuasively. Three apologists to watch and read are listed there. Some that I've been watching this week and giving consideration to. Maybe a whole book isn't what you're looking for. Maybe something more condensed, a 20-page summary. There's a link to a site there. Life Training Institute that gives a more condensed version of the case for life. And then maybe you don't even want that. Maybe a four-minute video that gives you one topic, and maybe another four-minute video another week. There's a whole series of videos that I've included in there with some links that you can bring up to take a look at. I'm not advocating we need to become professional debaters. It seems there are precious few people whom God has gifted to retain dozens of points and illustrations at the forefront of their mind for ready access in the moment of a conversation. That may not be you. It's certainly not me. But it might be good to be armed with two or three for those conversations. Let's take care of people. Let's learn and prepare well for conversations. Let's guard our attitudes. Let's pray. Let's serve. Let's give. Let's engage in persuasion. And let's point people to the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ proclaimed in the gospel. That's what we want to do even as we take communion together today. On the fourth Sunday of each month, we gather and talk about communion, give a focus to this time. Let me take just a few moments and give some explanation of that. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, that is, that you have repented of sin, that you're relying on what Christ has done, you've received his gift of forgiveness. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, and you are in fellowship with him, and you're in fellowship with each other, then you're invited to participate in this. And you don't need to be a member here, but you do need to be a member of the faith of Jesus Christ. We understand communion as a memorial. It's a time the Lord commanded us to remember him, and particularly his death, his burial, his resurrection on our behalf. You're not saved by taking communion. You take communion because you're already saved. See the difference? All right? So just want to be clear on that. We're cautioning God's word to examine our lives before we partake, lest we partake in a hasty, ill-advised fashion. And so I'm going to encourage you to take some time to do that as music is played. You take some time. If there's confession that needs to take place because God pinpoints a sin in your heart and he says, what about this attitude, Brian? Oh, you're right, Lord. What about this? Maybe there's someone that you need to restore a relationship with. If you can't take care of that in the moments before we partake, then my encouragement is, let's pass on partaking today. You go restore the relationship. You get right with God. You get right with this individual. And then, come next month, let's celebrate as God has done a work of restoring. Let me ask if those who would come, who are going to serve, if they would come right now, take their positions here. In just a few moments, once we're ready for you, I'll invite you to come. Three different stations here in this room. There's a place there in 103 as they're gathering as well. There are gluten-free wafers. If that would be helpful to you, they're available in little packages on the table here as well. We're going to set these out, and then you feel free to come when you're ready. Take it back to your seat. Take a moment of prayer, and you may partake at your schedule there, all right? And then in a few moments, I'll close this back, and we'll sing together. All right, when you're ready, you may come. take just another minute if you need it to finish. On Sundays, when we celebrate communion together in the symbolic fashion, there is not only a celebration of the vertical relationship, but horizontal relationship. And so we also take up an offering, a special offering that assists us through our benevolence to minister to needs in the community. If you'd like to contribute toward that, there are boxes, wooden boxes, attached to the wall as you exit. Welcome your donation. If you want to mark it, though, specifically for that, either on your check or in an envelope that are available at those boxes, that way we earmark it specifically for that need. So thanks for your contribution toward that. Let me ask if the worship team would come and lead us in a closing song together.
Please stand again if you're able. Let's sing together.
bow with me? This is a hard topic, Lord. I come back to this foundational truth that we have found in the scriptures a reliable record of an amazing, amazing man. Yeah. That he went about Palestine healing people of debilitating diseases and unbelievable blindness, even raising the dead. What power was demonstrated. He lived an exemplary life. He loved you, God. He loved people. He demonstrated that. He taught the highest moral values. We find in him someone who in the face of the political powers of the day didn't flinch.
That's right.
Said what needed to be said. And yet was gracious and kind and welcoming to the most outcast of his society. And we see him and we say, ooh, I wish I could be like that. And the amazing thing is, that's your project, is that you're seeking to make us like him. And you invite us to trust in his provision on our behalf, his death, his burial, his resurrection, as dealing with our sin problem, and then giving us new life, putting your Holy Spirit within us, transforming us, starting a work, and then in your good pleasure to use us to minister to others, sinners that we are, to minister to others. So, God, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who rescued us, who exemplified what you were like, who invited us to a restored relationship with you through faith in him. Help us, Lord, to take care of people this week in his name as his representatives. We pray it. Amen. May God bless you. May he use you. Would you serve him well this week? Amen.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.